The League of Women Voters Troy area is happy to welcome you to this candidates forum for the Troy City Council general election. I am Karen Fabian, voter service chairperson for the League and tonight's moderator. This forum affords you the opportunity to meet the candidates whose names will appear on the November 5th ballot, running for 3 4-year term seats on the City Council for the City of Troy. You are asked to vote for not more than 3. As many of you know, the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan national organization which welcomes all persons of voting age as members. The League of Women Voters does not support or oppose any candidate or political party. It does take action in the interest in, it does take action in the public interest on particular issues after careful study and consideration by members. The League emphasizes the importance of individuals working together to achieve good government responsive to the needs of all persons. Tonight we have 5 of the 9 candidates running for 3 seats. The candidates are in alphabetical order: Ali Apahidian Jr., Wade Fleming, Steve Gottlieb, Ellen Hoderick, Ed Pennington. Candidates Thomas Kuhn and Scott Welburn have conflicts with the date and let us know ahead of time that they were not able to attend. Janice Daniels and Roger Walters did not present themselves this evening. The format for this candidates meeting has been established by the League of Women Voters Troy area. Due to the large number of candidates and the wish to ask as many questions as possible, candidates will not be giving opening and closing statements. We will go directly to questions. Candidates will be answering written questions submitted by the audience, as well as questions that have been submitted prior to this evening through email or mail. Questions submitted should be pertinent to the issues facing the current situation and future direction of the City of Troy. Members of the League will screen and have screened questions for duplication and appropriateness. All candidates will be given 1 minute to respond. I will be asking the questions 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So we are not going to ask all 5 candidates the same question. We'll kind of go back and forth so that we can get more questions in. The timekeeper, Pat Miola, is in the front row, and she will raise her hand when you have about 10 seconds left. May I remind the audience that there will be no comments from the floor during the question period. You will have an opportunity to speak with the candidates following this meeting. I will begin the question period with a question directed to Mr. Afahidian. Did I do it right? Thank you. Are there any decisions City Council has made in the last year that you would ask to have reconsidered?
One of the decisions that I believe City Council made in the last year or last several years has been the reduction in officers in the law enforcement of Troy. And I believe that was justified at the time because of the budget and because of the need to reduce the expenditures of the city. But I think considering the surplus and the uptick in the economy and the economy taking a turn for the better, I think that's something that should be reconsidered for this city.
Mr. Fleming.
Actually, I can't say that I would reverse any decision I had made based on the information I had at the time that I made it. The transit center is a hot topic, If we had known, the council had known at the time we weren't going to have title to the land, I think that would have affected a number of people's decision. I think we would reconsider that. Having done that, we are where we are and we must move forward. But you can only make decisions based on the information you have at the time. Unfortunately, I think we were under the impression that the lawsuit would not be overturned, the court decision would stand, and we would have title to the property today. We all know now, in hindsight, that hasn't happened. And I've talked to some other council members as well, and I think if we had known that we were going to be in this position, we would have been in a different situation, different boat. But having said that, we move forward.
Mr. Gottlieb.
No. Brevity's a lost art. But since I have a little more time, let me just say this. Actually, the answer is no. I would not try and go back and redo any decision or reconsider it, because I think when you elect good people, and you have to trust those people to make good decisions. So I have to support the citizens of Troy that made the decisions they did, and I think they've made great decisions to this point. And I just want to say, because I have a little bit of time left, I really appreciate the opportunity to be here with all good people. I've had an opportunity to meet all these people and tell you that no matter who you get, you're going to do well. So it's an honor to be here.
Thank you.
What does the word compromise mean to you? What do you think And do you think compromise is essential for a good council member? Ms. Hoderick.
I want to thank everyone for coming tonight and thank the League and the CMN for allowing this to happen for our community. Compromise has become a dirty word, hasn't it? I think compromise is what has brought us where we are in this city. There has been a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, a lot of two sides coming together, and we saw a city council that wrestled through that. The 0.7 mil library was a compromise. The discussions on the transit center were a compromise. The reductions on police were a compromise. Compromise has brought us where we are. Our council and our mayor have brought us to a place, a very good place, for moving forward. And compromise needs to continue to be part of the discussion. We need to listen to one another, hear one another's ideas, and we can move forward in that light.
Mr. Pennington.
I also want to thank the League of Women Voters for having us here tonight. I think I've met all the candidates here tonight also, and again, they are all great people, and I think these are the candidates you should choose from when voting. If you don't have the time to make time for the League of Women Voters, then you probably aren't worthy of consideration. But compromise, that's what government's all about. Every time in council, when an issue comes up, if it's you're going to have different people on different sides. So we have to compromise often in council. And when we come to a decision, it's usually in the middle. And compromise is part of our makeup.
To me, compromise means making a decision that's in the best interest of everybody in Troy. Our community is so diverse in terms of individuals, in terms of family, in terms of ethnicity, in terms of businesses. And compromise is about finding the solution that is best for the majority of people. The solution that's best for everybody, that will probably never happen. That's the ideal solution. That's the ideal scenario. But compromise is about looking at the facts, looking at all the facts, looking at all the information, and then making a decision based on what we believe to be true and what we believe to be in accordance and alignment with the vision that Troy has and the goals that Troy has for the future. So compromise is about coming together, working together, and actually having the same vision for the future, not just short term, but long term.
County, state, and federal monies for road repairs are getting harder and harder to get. Will Troy have to pay for more county, state, and federal road repairs? Where will the money come from? Mr. Fleming.
The answer is yes. I believe Troy will have to step up and pay more. Actually, we're doing it now. The intersection at I-75 and square left, actually called the Crooks intersection, was an intersection that the city had to add funds to the county to complete that project. So I think it will. Where the funds will come from, we all know we have some excess fund balance now, a pretty healthy reserve, which I'm not ashamed of. I think it's a good position to be in with the envy of many cities now. So I think we're going to be having a study session on November the 25th, this council will, and we'll be determining how to utilize those funds. Personally, I think there's going to be a number of ways to use it, but one way will be put money toward the infrastructure, that being roads and sewer, water projects and things of that nature. But absolutely, we cannot depend on the federal government or our county. We're a donor city, federal, state, and county. We need to get more of our money back.
Mr. Gottlieb.
Well, nothing's for free. So if you want good roads, you have to pay for them. And one way or another, you're going to pay, because if you have bad roads, then what happens is you pay for it in car repairs. And I don't know anybody who wants to go out saying that, you know, well, I want to go bet. Well, there is one person. and, well, that was not but I think that pretty much everybody agrees that the part of the city that the municipal government is responsible for is providing roads for us, and it's to the benefit of all of us. So, you know, we're going to, you want something good, you pay for it. It's just that simple.
Ms. Aldrich.
The roads are a priority for me. I think it became very clear to me watching the study sessions last spring. If you watch Bill Hootery give a roads presentation, your eyes will cross, you'll feel back like you're back in trigonometry in high school and wonder how this man could know so much. It's a huge challenge, and he was explaining how every dollar we do not spend now is going to cost us more later. And that's where we just have to be very wise, and I encourage everyone, if you haven't had a chance, if you have strong opinions about what happens with our general reserve, please watch those study sessions, because it grounds you in the realities of our city. Our city is a key place along I-75. We have to attract business. It's kind of like having to buy a new washing machine. We need our roads to look right to attract businesses and residents to this community.
Tell us your skills and specific experiences that you bring to the council. Tell us about specific issues you are passionate about, their relevance to our community, and your level of competence to resolve them. Mr. Pennington.
Oh, no, it's an easy one. Well, when I was appointed on council 11 months ago, it was a council that hadn't worked well together, and that's my skill. I think I bring a team-oriented approach, and I'm a bridge builder. I was able to work together and work with the council and in a non-contentious way, and we had everybody together on many different issues. I think I bring that to the table. And
Mr. Alfahidian.
I've worked as a civil engineer for the past 17 years, and the last 12 years have been for the Road Commission of Oakland County, and I'm currently part of the Road Commission for Oakland County. And I believe that considering the urgency and the priority that even the city management office has given to rebuilding our roads and the infrastructure, and also the majority of the candidates here tonight made a priority of that as well as part of their campaign. I think that it goes without saying that one of the priorities that our city has is for that. And as an engineer for the Road Commission, I'm very familiar with everything that pertains to roads in terms of funding, in terms of familiarity with Act 51, with tri-party funding, the engineering aspect of roads, the traffic mitigation, congestion mitigation, every aspect that has to do with road reconstruction, I'm familiar with. I can bring that to the city, and for the next 4 years, we can definitely invest in the infrastructure into the roads.
Mr. Fleming.
I have an accounting major. I've worked many years in business. I retired as president and CEO of a tier one automotive supplier. budgets are so important, and I spend a lot of time studying the budget, working on the budget. But I'm passionate about this city in many areas, but none more so than the safety of our residents. I'm passionate about having a strong police department, Troy being the number one safest city in the state and the country. We're almost there. We want to get our police department back to that level, and we're not far from it now. Next would be our infrastructure and roads, which is going to help attract businesses. But I'm passionate about redeveloping the Maple Road corridor and getting businesses back into this area so that they share 60% of the taxes and residents about 40%. Right now it's reversed, it's flip-flopped.
What volunteer activity in the city of Troy have you participated in, and in what capacity?
So in terms of volunteer activity, and I don't think you could really classify teaching as a volunteer activity.
Do you pay?
I'll leave that alone for right now. But let me say this. I was chair of the fundraising, the All-Night Fundraising and Prize Committee. I have participated just recently this past year. I was the district representative that went to Madison District, and it was a great experience to go look at a different school district. It was a very unique district in that it had under one roof elementary, middle, and high school, and the superintendent of schools walked down the hallway with us and had an opportunity. Every person he walked by, he called out by name and knew them, and it was really interesting to see what a local community was like, and I could bring that back to Troy and share that. So there, I've been I'm the sole high school representative on the Continuous Improvement Committee for the high school. I chair the
Ms. Hoder.
Proof positive of how passionate I am about Troy in this role is the fact that I am missing right now the MSBOA marching band event at Troy High School. That being a part of the Troy High Band Boosters, being a volunteer with Bemis Elementary, Bolin, all-night parties, the Troy Foundation for Educational Excellence at my church. I'm a backstage leader. Hopefully, if you go to my church, you've never seen me. I'm supposed to be stealth and never seen. I like to be behind the scenes, helping others do great things. And those experiences working with people, we never asked one another if we were Republican or Democrat, or none of those conversations came up. Are you Muslim? Are you Christian? We just came together and did things well. I want to do the same with City Council.
Mr. Pennington.
Well, you can tell by some of my answers, I'm not a politician. I was a football coach for 12 years, and most of those years were in Troy for the Troy Cowboys. We also worked with the Troy Athletic Boosters, Troy Athens Athletic Boosters, and with the Troy Baseball Boosters. Phyllis and I also went to Kensington Church, and I helped out in the drama team there. I was a pilot out of Oakland Troy Airport, and we volunteered there at the hangar. Been in Troy. Our business has been in Troy for 45 years, kind of a staple in the community. And we've always supported the Troy Police. There was an intersection that was right near the shop, and we were always the first ones on the scene at accidents, and we were always assisting the Troy Police. So we've always been active in the Troy community.
Could the candidates please define what being nonpartisan means to them? Mr. Alfahidian.
Nonpartisan to me actually means, first of all, understanding the citizens of Troy, understanding their diversity, understanding that everybody has a different background, everybody has different principles, different lifestyle, different families, different heritage. And to me, that means being able to understand everybody, where they're at, understand their thinking, understand their positions, respect everybody for their opinion, respect everybody for where they stand on different issues, and come together as a community and come together for the issues that really matter, for the issues that really matter for the future of our city, for the future of our children.
Mr. Fleming.
Thank you. Nonpartisan means after the election, you listen to everybody. It doesn't matter what party you are. Now, most people know that I'm a Republican. I don't shy away from that. But when the election takes place, you represent everybody in Troy. It doesn't matter. Republican, Democrat, Independent, doesn't matter what religion, whatever. You represent everybody. And I think I've been able to demonstrate, and hopefully I have, and I think see some of you out here as evidence, that I listen, it doesn't matter what party you're with. And you have to do that as a council person. You have to put that aside. National issues are important, no doubt about that. We all have our convictions and values on those. But you represent as a council person every single citizen in the city of Troy. And you have to demonstrate that by going out and listening, going to people's homes, meeting them where they are, and not holding any grudges whatsoever, because things have a tendency to change. And I think I've grown quite a bit in that area.
Mr. Gottlieb.
So I agree with everybody. And I would also add to that, that to me, a nonpartisan position is one where political or ideological platforms really shouldn't drive or guide our decisions. That what we need to be doing is looking at what the community wants, needs, is willing to pay for, and will benefit the most number of individuals. So at the end of the day, when we're all done, we should all leave as friends, because we can pursue other agendas in different venues. But really, the nonpartisan aspect of it is, I'm a dad, I'm a parent, I'm a homeowner, I'm a community member. All of those things take precedence over those political and ideological statements.
Based on your vision for the city, what are the top three policy changes that you would like to see made within the coming year? Ms. Hoderick.
Policy changes? I guess I would like to continue just emphasizing what has been occurring with City Council. We need to move forward building our sense of community back up, and I think we've come a long way in that regard. Mayor Slater and, yes, Ed Pennington, Wade Fleming, and the other council members have really demonstrated leadership in coming together on tough decisions, and that is a policy we all need to get behind in this community. Fact-based, honest conversation that moves us forward with logical decision-making that protects our property values, draws businesses to the community. That's what we're about as a community. The policy of protecting the AAA bond rating is key to keeping our millage rate low, and services, the policy of trying to protect the services as best we can.
Mr. Pennington.
I don't know if there are policy changes as such, but the issues that are in front of council now that are important are bringing more police back into the police force. We've allocated more money in the budget towards that. That's important. All the other candidates have mentioned this, but the infrastructure, we have a budget surplus, which is a great thing to have. Most cities don't have that. So the study session that Wade talked about that we're going to have in November is going to address that. So policy changes per se, I'm not into big policy changes. When I was asked to help out on council, it was a council that was divided, and I united the council, and I'm just looking forward to moving the city forward and tackling issues as they come up.
Mr. Apahidian.
One of my goals when I decided to run for city council was to really dig deep and find out more about the history of Troy in terms of council decisions and policies that were actually made in the past. And what I did was I actually read the past 10 years of council meeting minutes. And I dug in deep and I looked at everything that was decided in the past 10 years. And I can tell you that just looking back at that, I wouldn't really change anything. I think the policies have been solidly built up until now in the last 10 years. And it's more of fine-tuning the policies that we actually have in place right now and actually moving forward with issues like the transit center that polarized the city. Now it's time to just have a new vision, start over, and look at how that can benefit our city. So things that have been in the past that have been polarizing to the city, it's time to move forward. So I would definitely not change policies, just fine-tune what we already have.
Will you support renewal of the library millage, Mr. Fleming?
I think we'll have to determine if that is necessary or not. certainly the library is important. It's a jewel in this community. We want to keep it. I don't think there was anyone on council that ever really wanted to close this. I know there was not. We just had to find a way to keep it open. Now knowing we have the fund balance, I think on November the 25th, that's one thing we'll be looking at. Do we use some of that fund balance to fund the library? Maybe we won't need an extra millage. Let's don't use it if we don't need it. But I think we just have to determine that need. But certainly the library, I'd like to see it open more hours, not less hours. And I think many of the residents would like as well. So I'll be looking for a way, we're looking at the fund balance, the reserve that we have, to try to look at the library and determine if we can use some of that money there as well. But there are a number of other areas that we talked about as well with the roads and so forth. But library is an integral part of this community, and we'll keep it open.
Mr. Gottlieb.
So that's kind of like a lightning rod for controversy when you ask that type of thing. Would you support the millage for the library? And it's a polarizing issue. So I understand that, but I want to make my answer clear. I support the library, period, because my kids go there, because other kids go there, and because as a teacher, it's an essential component in our community. And when it's closed, a lot of times it needs to be open. So in that context, let there be no mistake. I support the library. I also support what the citizens of Troy want for the community. So I think that, you know, it would be arrogant for me to say, we're gonna do this. I think what needs to happen is you need to have clear, open, honest discussion and dialogue so that individuals can voice their opinion and their concerns and consider many options.
Ms. Hoderick.
Well, many of you know the library was a very passionate point for me, and I fought for the millage to protect it in a fiscally responsible way. I studied the numbers, I studied the budgets, I studied the realities. I saw the look on our city assessor's face when the long-term view of property values was coming through, and we were looking at the severe cuts we've taken in our police department, our DPW. Going forward, oh, I hope we won't have to go through that again. I hope our community will be in a place, and the economy will be in a place, that conversation, that very difficult conversation that council had to have and the community had to wrestle with. We went through a tough time. Our property values plummeted and the money coming in plummeted. And you had a council that was saying something to you that none of us really wanted to hear, but we grasped it and we moved forward. Let's have the honest conversation as we do go forward. And yes, I would protect the library.
What do you believe are Troy's three most important assets, and what is your plan to leverage them? Mr. Pennington.
Well, Troy's three most important assets, the first thing would be the people of Troy. The people of Troy, it's a diverse city, and it's a great city. To have a business and to live in the city of Troy and to work for the city of Troy has been an honor of mine. The police force is second to none. They've been rated the highest in the state and in the nation, keeping us safe. And the fire department. I mean, the fire department is a volunteer organization that only has a few paid employees, but they serve the city well, and they save us hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Mr. Epahidian. Oh, go ahead.
I agree with Mr. Pennington. I strongly believe that the most important asset, the most valuable asset that the city has is its people, its residents. And its residents, it's not only the residents, but actually the individuals that make up our community, and that includes business owners as well. And having said that, I believe that what we have as a police department, that's one of the most valuable assets that our community has, because we value and we put a high priority on our safety of our communities, our neighborhoods, our schools, our businesses. That's what attracts businesses here, that's what attracts residents to our community, is the safety. Another asset that I believe we have that is valuable is our roads. We need to preserve the roads, we need to invest in the roads and our infrastructure, because what that does is that creates a domino effect that attracts more businesses, the businesses attract more customers, the customers spend more, and the spending brings more revenue to the city in terms of taxes. So I believe that's one. Another one is our school districts, and that's a value. Those three are values and assets for our city.
Mr. Fleming.
I think we all agree our residents, the diversity of our residents, are our most valuable asset. Second, I want to add something a little different here, and I agree with what everything was said, everybody said here tonight, but our employees, our staff at the city, wonderful assets. The tenure they have, the police department all the way through the city, wonderful assets. The third, but I'd say our businesses. We absolutely must have businesses here that continue to grow and attract business here, because that's where our tax base needs to grow. Because right now we're not getting enough revenue from our businesses. To keep the businesses here, we need the good roads we've talked about. We need the safety, and then our schools. Absolutely, everywhere I go, I hear about our excellent school system, and we have to maintain that. So with our staff, our good employees, good schools, businesses, and residents all working together.
Now that the transit center is built and is ready to open, how do we make sure that we get the full utility from it? Mr. Gottlieb.
Oh, thanks for that one. So here's the deal with the transit center. You guys are looking for a soundbite to throw in, not you in particular, but you're looking for a soundbite to a very, very complicated, in-depth issue. And there's no quick answer, and it goes with the answer to the previous question that I was asked that can't be answered in a one-minute response. But I will say this, and to the credit of the city manager and the current council members, I sat in on a meeting with the city manager, and the opportunity was there to ask questions. And I asked some really deep questions with respect to how did we get into the position with the transit center where we are. And the answer would surprise you, because it did surprise me. It was resolved through a consent judgment, and it was a mitigating factor for a previous issue. So it's a much larger issue than just a simple how do we get the biggest bang for our buck and how do we resolve it. It's part of the overall comprehensive communication that needs to occur.
Ms. Hoder.
Can I ask for the question one more time?
Sure. Now that the transit center is built and is ready to open, how do we make sure that we get the full utility from it?
We need to come together behind it. This argument is done, over, behind us. Whatever happens at the court level happens. This is our transit center. It belongs to Troy. So if we come behind it, together with our business community that has always been behind it, and speak positively about it as an opportunity and an asset to our community, we can help it reach that vision. I realize there are people who didn't see it as part of the vision for Troy, okay? Let's agree, maybe you were right, but the fact of the matter is the building is there, the bus systems are going to use it, the trains will come to it. We just saw a presentation from the Troy Chamber president Monday night, who he sounded very excited about it and what they're going to do down the road. We need to get excited about it too, speak positively about it. We need to help manage our reputation together, and that's what it will take.
Mr. Pennington.
That's exactly what we need. We need to get behind the transit center businesses, the citizens. We have talked, a couple of us on council have talked about taking a trip on a train to Chicago as soon as the transit center opens to promote it. I myself personally don't travel much by train, but my daughter does. And so she's looking forward to using the transit center. But once we all get behind it, it doesn't matter if you support it or not before, it's a train that's not only coming, it's here. So get behind it and to make it successful, and we can do that with everyone behind it.
What do you feel is the appropriate status of the Stage Nature Center and the Troy Historical Village? Should the city continue to subsidize them while keeping them as a volunteer organization? Mr. Afahidian.
I believe that those three are very valuable to the identity of our city. They're valuable to the culture of the generation growing up in terms of understanding the history of Troy. And the position that Troy is in currently with the general fund surplus, I think that should be a consideration to refund some of those services, to make those healthier, to bring their funds to a healthier level, to a level that previously existed in the last couple of years. And I think those funds exist. It's just a matter of priority. It's just a matter of priority by the city management. And I think that if Troy residents actually request that, that should be a consideration that should be on the table.
Mr. Fleming.
The Nature Center and the Historical Village are both jewels in this city, and we need to keep them healthy. I'm impressed by what's taking place at both of these entities now. We have volunteer groups, they have their own boards, they're doing their own fundraising. We had an excellent presentation just Monday night from the Troy Historical Village. Top-notch people who've given their time worth tens of thousands of dollars to put together a business plan, a strategic plan. Very impressive. I think they're on the right track. I like the way it's going. I like to see the volunteerism. We think more of the community needs to get behind it. I think the city will have to continue to pour funds there, but not to the extent we were years ago. Years ago, we were putting $500,000 a year or more into the historical village. I think those days are behind us, but they are jewels. We need to keep them. The city needs to maintain some support, but most of the support is going to come from their private fundraising.
Mr. Gottlieb.
Both of those entities, I think, we all benefit from both of them. And I've used them, and my children have used them, our family uses them, and it's a nice thing to have in our city. And I understand people that don't want to write a blank check for that. But if you look at some of the things, some of the more innovative ideas that have been used to address maintaining them, for example, the Boy Scouts had Eagle Scouts there doing maintenance, and that's the type of thing that instead of just writing a check, you can involve more community members. And when they see that there's a benefit to maintaining the things that we have that benefit all of us, that's an opportunity for people to become more involved, see the value of it, and reduce the cost associated with those entities.
There is talk of another downturn or recession, possibly brought on by the federal debt problems. Is the city of Troy ready to react in the best interests of the city? Ms. Hoderick.
We were talking a few minutes ago about assets, and one of them is our general reserve fund and our AAA bond rating. Our economy is tender. The comeback is slow, and it's going to take more time for it to come back. One of our assets is that fund balance. Mr. Fleming mentioned the employees. We have so much talent, so much institutional memory, so much depth of understanding in our city staff. Yes, I think we are very well positioned to leverage those two key assets. The additional asset is our new city manager, Brian Kitchnick. Everyone has come behind this gentleman. He fits Troy, he's part of us, and the trust has been rebuilt. I think we're in a great position to ride out a downturn if it happens.
Mr. Pennington.
Every city will be affected if there's another economic downturn. Troy will not be any different. But we are different in that we have money in our reserve fund, which most cities do not right now. We still need to, there are many vacancies in the businesses that we have. There's many buildings that are vacant, and we need to work to fill those vacancies. But as far as, the city of Troy struggling through an economic downturn, you know, I think everyone will be affected, but, you know, we won't be affected as much as some other cities.
Mr. Apahidian.
I've looked at the budget for last fiscal year and the fiscal year that just started October 1st, and just like the previous candidates mentioned, that our general fund is very robust. I think in terms of the surplus that's in the general fund, Troy has not been in this position for decades. So if there is a downturn, I think Troy is positioned to actually take the downturn and to be able to have the funds for whatever needs to be allocated and reappropriated in whatever department and whatever area where the budgets are lacking or the budgets are in the minus. But I think that we are positioned, and the personnel and the general and the actual city manager, together with the personnel and the staff of Troy and our and the budget surplus, I think Troy is positioned very well if the downturn does occur.
What would you propose for the use of the vacant Kmart headquarters building on Big Beaver and Coolidge, and what action should be taken to make it happen? Mr. Fleming.
Well, unfortunately, that's not city property. That belongs to the Somerset Collection now, and I'm sure they have plans for it. You know, we had a beautiful plan for that years ago, but it fell through due to the economy. But right now, I know there have been some discussions between city management and the owners of the Somerset Collection, Forbes and those people. But right now, I think they're waiting for the economy to turn as well a little more, and I think they will be doing something that's very attractive that will not compete with the Somerset Collection. You got to understand, they bought that at a bargain price to protect themselves. But we all know that property is worth more with those buildings down than they are up, because they've been condemned by the state. So I'd love to see something happen with that property. That's something that it's up to the owners today, and we really need them to do something, but I can understand it's an economic discussion and decision for them, not us.
Mr. Gottlieb.
So as a realtor, I feel pretty strongly that property rights that an individual purchases property with should remain with that. I don't know that the council as it arrives is going to be able to make that decision. It's the people that preceded us that had a master land use plan, and if we follow that master land use plan and use it for its intended usage and maintain a balance of commercial and residential properties, that we will end up with the support from both, and an appropriate amount of support from both business and residential communities. I don't know that we can restructure after the fact what we want to do with it. I think that we have to honor the individuals that have purchased the property with the knowledge of its current zoning. Certainly we can encourage and offer suggestions, but you have to honor your commitments.
Ms. Hoder.
I guess I want to say I agree with that discussion. What I want to see happen there is something that's viable, makes sense to the property owner, does not detract from, you know, the rest of the Big Beaver corridor, that complements our city. I trust our master plan. It was thoughtfully, creatively, innovatively brought together. And whatever goes there needs to be consistent with that plan. We have an outstanding planning commission, and there's been a great deal of work involving business partners. So what I'd like to see there is what makes sense, what brings us dollars into this community, what fits Troy. I have no idea what that would be. We can dream together, but hopefully the property owner will, as the economy comes back, bring that to bear.
Would you institute cost-benefit analysis to slightly lowering the rainy day fund to paying off some of the outstanding debt? Mr. Pennington.
A cost-benefit analysis. I can't answer that question. If it pertains to bringing money into the budget in the city of Troy and paying down our debt at a reasonable rate, then I would be for it.
Mr. Apahidian.
As an engineer, and especially as a civil engineer, that's always something that is done prior to making any decision that involves the cost of either an agency or the cost of residents. Cost-benefit analysis is a priority for anything, and so I believe that even in this situation, that's something that should be a priority before any decision is made if something needs to be paid down. And that's something that needs to be done very detailed with the facts and the information, and a cost-benefit analysis usually leads to the correct answer just based on the facts.
Mr. Fleming.
Yes, I've utilized cost-benefit analysis my whole career as an accountant. But specific to this question, to pay down debt, I'm going to make an assumption that the person, and I may be wrong, that posed that question is talking about the DDA bonds. That's the huge debt. No, I would not use the fund reserve balance to pay off DDA bonds. We've worked diligently to come up with a plan for that and to fund those bonds and reissue those bonds. And we have a plan. So if you're referring to the DDA bonds, that ship has sailed. We would not use fund reserve to pay that off. So I don't know what other debt you're talking about. But as far as utilizing cost-benefit analysis, absolutely. It's used all the time in determining whether to outsource various departments and so forth. And we're always looking at continuous improvements and ways to do that. But to pay down debt, if you're talking the DDA bonds, absolutely not.
Has the outsourcing that took place in the last several years been a good thing for the city, or do we need more, less, or the same amount of outsourcing than what we have presently? Mr. Gottlieb.
So how did I get all the lightning rod first time around?
The center.
Here's the deal with that. There's no question that there is an appropriate time and place to reassess where our budget priorities are. But as was just demonstrated at the most previous city council meeting, there are certain occupations, there are certain positions, there are certain jobs that you cannot put a cost-benefit analysis to without considering the intrinsic value of having an individual with a strong commitment to the community. And, you know, we have some individuals in our community. Look at our fire department, for example. You do a cost-benefit analysis, we win. We have low taxes because you have committed people willing to work for us, in essence, nothing. So I'll look at it.
Ms. Hoderick.
I get so busy listening, I forget what the question was.
Well,
outsourcing.
Pay down debt.
See, I'm a listener, so I apologize. Outsourcing, boy, that is a lightning rod topic. And that has happened in the city of Troy as we work to get the best bang for our taxpayer buck. And I think there have been some outstanding decisions going forward if it made sense. And staff brought forward a business case that made sense both for the city and for the bottom line. Of course, I would consider that. I'm not against outsourcing. I think it was the wise idea for our golf courses, for example. But I agree with Mr. Gottlieb. You know, there are some soft sides to business. That intrinsic value of something being internal with highly educated, highly experienced people with a vested interest because they live here doing that work. And that's a trade-off we have to manage very, very carefully.
Mr. Pennington.
Being a businessman, you have to look at, you know, cost analysis on every little thing that comes through the door. So you can look at the different departments and to see if they can be outsourced, but sometimes it just doesn't make sense. We just looked at the city's attorney's office, and it didn't make sense to look at outsourcing. We will look at different departments and see if it makes sense to even look at that possibility. But it's not always about dollars and cents. It's about the people that work for the city, keeping people that work for the city that are quality people, and they can't be looking over the shoulder all the time. So it's not always about, you know, dollars and cents. It's about, you know, keeping, what kind of city do you want? Well, we want a great city, and you have to keep good quality employees for that.
I have the last question to ask of the evening, and this time we're going to go straight down the line because it's that kind of a question. Assume it is the year 2050. What will the city of Troy be like, and what will you have done during your time on city council to make that future happen? Mr. Apahidian.
Dream.
2050, let's see. 2050, I'll be walking down Big Beaver with my grandkids. I think 2050 would look, Troy in 2050 will be a thriving, booming city with walkable areas, a lot more open space, a lot more walkable area. Probably the transit center is just a beginning of something that would be mass transit. Probably down Big Beaver would be a light rail system, booming shopping, a lot more shopping than exists today down Big Beaver. And I think there are a lot of projects that could be in line for bringing more culture to the city, more in terms of culture, in terms of art, in terms of theaters and things like that. And I think Troy would be a booming place in 2050, a lot better, a lot safer than it is today, and definitely something, a place that a lot of people would want to be.
Mr. Fleming.
If I'm lucky enough to be here in 2050, God willing, my grandson will be chauffeuring me or pushing me around, I hope. And it'll be a great place. I'm telling you, I think we've got the stage set for Troy to just boom for the future. We've been through some difficult times. We're going to face some difficult times in the future. But we have resilient residents. We have resilient and good city employees. We have businesses that want to be here. We're attracting more and more businesses. We have the best schools. And the best thing you can do is educate your children and have a place for them to come back and want to come back to live and play. I think we're going to be doing things in the next several years that are really going to help all of our children and our grandchildren want to live here rather than move away. And I think that Troy is going to be a fantastic place in 2050. Wow, that sounds like a long time.
Mr. Godley.
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. I think that in 2050 at the League of Women Voters, the event that's being podcast to everybody, the city is going to have a party saying thank you, the group that voted the right way in the 2013 November 5th election.
Hopefully the right way includes a vote for Ellen Hoderick. Part of a community that set the stage for a city that is not unlike, an Alexandria type place that we see in the DC area, a destination place that's just awesome, just north of this beautiful place called Detroit, that enjoyed a resurgence because the state and the region came behind it to help it rebuild, and the suburb just north of it kept itself strong and safe with a great school district and great places to live and great places to shop and great places to have your business. That would be my view of how we would fit into the region and the state, kind of an Alexandria-like place in the midst of the region.
Mr. Pennington.
In 2050, I'll be 89 years old, so if Ollie's still walking, he'll be pushing me around in my wheelchair, because the way I run, I still play baseball with the kids on the church softball team, and I plan on wearing out this body before I give it back to God. But we'll be celebrating 85 years in business at Pennington Collision, so I'll probably still manage in the shop, but I won't be in city council then, put it that way, but I will be looking back as part of a team that took the city of Troy from a time where they were in turmoil and had negative headlines in the city council, and I came in, was able to bridge a gap and to have a normalcy return to the city council that I hadn't seen in a while. Friends tell me now, they say, wow, when I watch the meetings on council now, they seem boring. Well, I like boring.
The League of Women Voters Troy Area would like to thank the candidates and the audience for your participation. In addition to the Troy City Council race, there will be a ballot proposal for the Troy School District. Full wording of the Troy School District Improvement Bond Proposition is on the school website and the League website. Voters may find information about all candidates on the November 5th Troy City Council general election ballot by going to a new election information website. Vote411.org is a nonpartisan website that presents information about candidates and proposals. A voter's guide and bookmark with the websites are available at the back of the room and in the Troy Public Library and City Hall. You may also access this information via the League of Women Voter Troy Area website, which is www.lwvtroyarea.org. This forum will be rebroadcast several times on CMN-TV, on Cablecast Channel 18 and WOW Channel 18. Please check CMN's website schedule for dates and times. In addition, this entire program will be available for viewing on your computer by going to www.cmntv.org and clicking on Video on Demand. Again, we thank you for your participation. Please remember to vote on November 5th. The polls are open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Democracy is not a spectator sport. Thank you.